Hello everybody, Lou Goblin here. Thank you for joining me for my comic book review for this particular week of June 2015. This is incredibly late, but I am here to let you know I am not dead, I'm not going away. I'm just trying to catch up. I got no other excuse. Been real busy here lately, so I'm gonna try. Let's give it a try. And for this week, I got a large stack of books. And yeah, let's just go ahead and get started with this one, shall we? We're gonna start with Dynamite. We're gonna start with Legendary Red Sonja number 4. Mark and Draco is still doing the writing on this. In here, we get to see Sonja. You know, she questioned, is this how I was meant to die? And she's about to get eaten by a shark, and Captain Nemo shows up and helps her out. And he's no longer, you know, a pawn for Victor Frankenstein, so he is now going to help Sonja. I like where this is going. And the story is really, really playing up Victor Frankenstein as a complete fucking lunatic. My God, they have really turned up the insanity factor on this motherfucker. And some of the stuff that he does in here, some of the stuff that he's done in this storyline, it's really fucked up. And really paints a picture of just how psychotic is this guy. Just really good, really strong storytelling in here. The plot flows very well, just really, really nicely done. And what a fucking cliffhanger at the end of the issue. Just really, really good shit. Victor decides to unveil some of his newest creations, you know, for our heroes and everything. And wow, what a cliffhanger. Fucking awesome. Thought it was a strong and a solid read. I enjoyed it. I give it a 4. Alright, we're moving on to DC. We're starting DC off with Green Lantern number 41. Robert Venditti and Billy Tan still do the writing and the artwork on here. I really didn't know what to think about this when I read it. I really didn't. It's like, okay, let me get this straight. Hal Jordan quits the Green Lantern Corps, yet he's still acting like a Green Lantern, just a bit of a bad cop routine. The beginning and the middle parts of the book just didn't really capture me. It didn't really do anything for me because all I saw was Hal Jordan with longer hair and a bit much of an attitude, and more of an attitude. That's pretty much it. He's still acting like a Green Lantern. Then here's my question: why the fuck did he quit to begin with if he's gonna take one of their weapons and still act like a goddamn Green Lantern? That would be like if a police officer quit the force yet still wanted to serve and protect and uphold the law. Alright, you still want to serve and protect and uphold the law, then why'd you relinquish your badge then? It's just how it felt. I'm not saying that's exactly how it is. It's just how it felt to me when I was reading the story. But that cliffhanger at the end of the book, yes, we're going to another cliffhanger bragging here. The cliffhanger at the end of this issue. Oh shit. That's all I have to say. The rest of the book didn't really do nothing for me, but that ending got my attention. But still, it takes more than just one solid moment to really win me overall with a book. So this is what it is. I'm gonna give it a 3. Okay. We're ending DC with The Wonder Woman Annual, number 1. Was this worth the $5. In my opinion, yes, it was. Finch and Finch are at it again. Really good stuff. Really good stuff. This is the conclusion to the war-torn storyline with Donna Troy trying to take over Themyscira and become the new queen of the Amazons, while Diana ain't having none of that shit. Let's see. Darino, I believe that's how it's pronounced, is still trying to pull the strings and trying to influence the Amazons. She's been trying to do that throughout this entire storyline. And she's doing that with Donna Troy in here. And for the most part, the fight between Diana and Donna is really, really good. Really impressive. And it got to the point where, is Diana going to withdraw from the fight and say that she's going to let Donna lead the Amazons? I thought that for just a tiny split second, but then I'm like, no, I'm going to stick with my gut and say Diana ain't having that shit. So Diana does win the fight, minor spoilers here, but what they do with Darino and with Donna Troy, I'm not going to ruin that. Just really, really good stuff, and the Amazon brothers get a proper funeral, you know, courtesy of their sister Diana. The second story was about Darino. I believe that's how you pronounce her name. It was about her and her relationship with Hippolyta. And I love that, you know, DC just flat out admitted Darino was Hippolyta's former lover. They were Amazonian sisters on Themyscira, but they were lovers. They were best friends, and they were lovers. You know, it's not implied, it's not suggested, it's flat out said in this second story. And I like that DC actually did have the balls to actually be open and admit, yes, some of the Amazons in Themyscira go beyond sisterhood and friendship. Some of them are lovers. You know, one of the worst kept secrets in the world for some Wonder Woman fans, for some Themyscira fans out there that I've talked to. But still, it was a nice touch for DC to actually state this as a fact. But we find out why Darino felt betrayed by Hippolyta. We get to see why. And at the end of the day, you kind of feel for her because she saves Hippolyta's life, and yet it ends up costing her. That's a bit harsh. You know, it is what it is. You know, Darino feels betrayed by Hippolyta because by saving Hippolyta's life, she sacrificed her beauty, she sacrificed her youth, only to watch Hippolyta fall into the arms of another woman, and then eventually fall into the arms, for the first time, fall into the arms of a man, which happened to be Zeus. And then the last page shows where that all led to. Led to Diana and the Amazon brothers, you know. But the second story really dug into detail with the drama and with the character development, and the, you know, just the storytelling overall was really, really solid. The first story had the better action, had the better conclusion. It had the better conclusion, but both stories really nailed it for me. I thought this was really solid storytelling, really solid action, good plot direction. Everything that needed to happen in here happened, and I was pleased with this. I really thought this was $5 well spent. I do recommend this annual, folks. If you didn't pick it up, if you missed out on it, it's not too late. Get this book and look at it and just admire it. I thought it was wonderful. Really good stuff, pardon the pun. Just solid stuff. I give it a 4. Not perfect, but it was great. We're going to Marvel. We're starting Marvel off with Amazing Spider-Man. Amazing Spider-Man number 18.1. 718.1 if you're keeping track for the real numbers. Jerry Conway. Oh my god. This was good. Was it Was it jaw-droppingly great? No. This is the next part. This is part three of Spiral. Black Cat stepping into the fray. I'm still not a fan of what they're doing with Black Cat. It's like she has just become heartless and unforgiving. If she would just slow down and let Peter try to explain to her what the fuck happened when Otto was running the show, maybe she could be, I don't know, a better developed character and actually fucking understand what's going on. I mean, how many years has Felicia known Spider-Man? Of course, the retcon, the Brand New Day retcon probably fucked all that up. But at the same time, it's really fitting to the character of Spider-Man. He's trying to, you know, put aside his personal animosities, you know, to, you know, still fight for what he believes is right and all that other bull crap. But it's just, you know, mob warfare mixed with Spider-Man, and this is really good. Not great, but I really did enjoy it. But the cliffhanger at the end of the issue was really telling, and it was so good, I can't wait to read the next part of the story. It was that good for me, because it's nothing original. I've seen cliffhangers like this done thousands of times, but somehow Jerry Conway still makes it work, and I thought they delivered. Like I said, was it perfect? Absolutely not. But for what it was, in a nutshell, I enjoyed it, and I thought it was a solid read. It is what it is. I give it a 3.5. The Amazing Spider-Man, Renew Your Vows, number one. Oh, boy! They brought back the marriage! Bullshit! Bullshit! The marriage is not fully back. This is nothing more than a glimpse on what could have possibly been had the one more day deal never happened. This is what could have been. Peter, Mary Jane, and their child, I forgot what they called her. She's not called May. It's not Mayday Parker, folks. Annie. She's called Annie. Annie Parker. Yeah. It's like, I guess when people saw the solicitations for this, you know, they thought, oh, it's Mayday. They're going to find a way to, you know, bring Mayday back. They're going to bring back the marriage and they're all blah, 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 blah. Nope. This is just a glimpse. You know, Pete and MJ with their daughter Annie. And I love the beginning of this book. They're trying their best to act like a family the way it should be. The next step in Peter's growth. I thought this was splendidly done. And they don't even want to talk about Peter being Spider-Man in front of their child. I like that. I like that. You know, when you think about the character of Peter Parker, you think, okay, high school, college, you know, adulthood. You eventually would want to find a significant other that you want to settle down with, maybe start a family. You know, Peter Parker is supposed to be relatable to the average Joe, the everyday person, and you would think the everyday person, after growing up, would want to settle down and focus on his or her future. And you would think marriage and a family would be the next step, but Marvel's obsessed with keeping Peter Parker a humongous man-child that, you know, it just doesn't look right to them that Parker would actually want to fucking grow up. Which makes this glimpse ever more painful. You know, maybe I'm just speaking from personal experience. I'm in a relationship right now. I've graduated high school. I have a college degree. I have a full-time job. I'm in a relationship with a great woman whom I'm living with. I'm paying bills. You would think maybe one day we would want to start a family. You know, it's evolution. You would think you want to keep making those steps. But no, Peter can't do that. But it is nice to see how Peter could adjust to family life, in case you have never read anything from Spider-Girl. The rest of the stuff with the Avengers and this villain who has all the powers of the X-Men, I wasn't feeling anything there. I'm gonna tell you the truth. I mean, all the Avengers get killed off. All the X-Men are gone. Spider-Man is literally the only hero left, and he is now going into seclusion. Mary Jane mysteriously vanishes at the end of the book. Peter is now with a much older Annie and everything. Okay, whatever. I just loved the beginning of this book a hell of a lot better than I liked the ending of the book. That's just me. It is nice to see Peter take that step, but I'm just wondering, where are they going with this? Because I would just like to see Peter focus on being a dad. You know, even as Spider-Man. And I get to see that. But nothing else really grips me. Other than that, and I give this book a 3. Alright, we're going on to Battle World number 2. I gotta say, Battle World number 1 was, now that I've had more time to stew about it and think about it, number 1, I don't even think it was as good as I initially said it was, you know, because all it basically is just glimpses of realities that Marvel didn't bother to make miniseries for to tie into Secret Wars. That's pretty much all this is. And in here we get to see Blade in Duck World fighting alongside Howard the Duck. And by far the best part of this fucking book was seeing the duck equivalent of Blade enter the fray and what he fucking says. And I'm not going to give it away. That was easily the best part of this whole fucking book. The rest of the stuff with Thunderbolt Ross as War Machine and everything, I wasn't emotionally invested in that second storyline. But the stuff with Blade and Howard the Duck was actually really good, and I fucking loved the conversation they had at the end of that story. Just really fun. The other stuff I could care less about, to be perfectly honest. But this was fun for what it was. It was alright. The second, like I said, first story was good, second story, eh. So I'd give it a 3 as well. They tried. Alright, we're going to some Star Wars stuff. We're going to Darth Vader number 6. Wow! The writing, the artwork, this is fantastic! Any Star Wars fanboy or fangirl would love this. I'm not guaranteeing it, but I really honestly think they would. This is really good shit. You see Vader and you can tell, even though Darth Vader cannot give you any fucking facial expressions, you can tell in his body language, you can tell by the pacing and the direction of the storytelling that he's getting fucking frustrated with the Emperor's bullshit. You can tell. It's that well written. And the artwork is spectacular. Vader is clearly getting frustrated. He knows the Emperor's planning on replacing him. Even after all of his loyal years, his 2 decades plus of loyalty to the Emperor, to the Sith Lord, you can tell he's getting fucking fed up. Even if you can't see his face, even if you can't get the facial expressions, you know it's there. And it's really well written. It's so well done. This is awesome shit by Marvel. This makes me love the character of Darth Vader even more. You know, you can tell he's getting frustrated and he's not fucking whining or bitching about it. He's keeping to himself and thinking of a strategy, and he's coming up with plans. He's forming secret alliances to try and fuck the Emperor over, which is of course what's gonna happen in episode 6. Spoiler alert. But just, wow, really good. Was it perfect? Not quite, but really fun to read. Really good stuff. I'm loving this. I give this an easy 4, maybe even a 4.5. But for now, I've given it a 4. It was awesome. And speaking of awesome, Giant Size Little Marvel, A versus X. This was outstanding. Scotty Young, just fucking awesome. This was cute. It was funny. It was the right kind of comedy delivered. The right kind of dialogue. The right kind of storytelling. This was awesome. If I did a pick of the week for this week's books, it would be this one. This was amazingly fun. This was 10 times more fun than any issue of The Unbeatable Squirrel Girl is. This was even more fun than any issue of Harley Quinn I've read. Yes, I even fucking said that. This is really good shit, and I love the very first joke you see is on the goddamn cover. Two fucking Wolverines, because he's been on both teams. That's amazing. Just really good shit. Really well told. It was fun. I loved it. Can't really complain too much about it. This gets a 4.5. Going on to Princess Leia, number 4. This series is nearly ending. Mark Waid and the Dodsons. Phenomenal stuff. Leia showing the true loyal person that she is. In this book, she's willing to sacrifice herself for somebody she barely even knows because she feels like it's the right thing to do. That is a definition of heroism, folks. Very well done. But the way this book was told, the way the pacing was done, by the end of the issue, you know something's gonna happen, and you know that this particular miniseries is gonna end on a high note. It's got Mark Magic motherfucking Waid writing this stuff. It's gonna end with a boom, and I can't fucking wait. This was a fucking great read. I loved it. It easily gets a 4 from me. Next up, Secret Wars, number 3. Jonathan Hickman. Again, lots and lots and lots of talking. That's what you seem to get nowadays with Jonathan Hickman. Maybe I didn't notice it as much in the past when I read his work with Fantastic Four. Maybe I just didn't want to acknowledge it. Maybe I just didn't want to see it. But man, do I see it now. When Jonathan Hickman writes a book, you're going to see a lot of talking, a lot of exposition. And it hurts the book a bit because it makes the book tedious to read, and sometimes it can be a bit dull. The stuff that's going on in here, you got Thanos stepping into the picture, you got other characters stepping into the picture who have memories of how the universe was before Doom took over. You got Doctor Strange, who is one of Doctor Doom's right-hand men. He's also got memories of how the world was, and when he comes across other people who, and I'm not going to ruin who they were, but when he comes across other characters who know about the past and everything, it helps the storytelling flow. It helps me get through the tedious reading of reading so much fucking dialogue. And to me, this was a step up. I think they're going upwards in terms of pacing, in terms of storytelling, in terms of direction, and good character development. This was solid. I actually liked it. This is easily my favorite issue out of the series so far. The first issue was crap. The second one was but, you know, this one, okay, we're finally getting somewhere. Hopefully Marvel doesn't let me down. It is what it is, though. I give it 3.5. Alright, we're going to back to Star Wars. This is Star Wars number 6. Jason Aaron, John Cassidy. This is John Cassidy's last issue, which is a shame because I'm loving his artwork. He's like true to fashion when it comes to his artwork. You see Mark Hamill. You see Carrie Fisher. You see Harrison Ford. and when you read, when you're reading this stuff, and it's just fantastically done. I'm not usually a fan of artwork that tries to render characters after movie stars, but god damn it, this is the right franchise to do that with. If you're gonna do that, if you're going to draw your characters to look like people from a movie, this is the kind of stuff to do it with Star Wars. And in here we get to see Luke and Boba Fett, mano a mano. This was good shit. And Luke is able to win the day without his vision and everything. And I just love it. He says, I don't need to see you. Your armor is noisy. And he's like, well, so are you. Just really good stuff. And he finds something that belonged to Ben Kenobi, and he meant to give it to Luke. But then, towards the end of the book, we get to see something that we saw in this past issue of Darth Vader. We got to see something that we saw in there. Vader knows something. He knows something that the Emperor hasn't told him yet. Keep in mind, it would help you if you read these books pretending you haven't saw Empire Strikes Back yet. I keep saying this over and over again, but I feel like I have to keep reminding you. Try to get into that mindset of not seeing episode 5 yet, and it helps the storytelling. It helps those reveals have much more of an impact overall when you're reading the story and when you're seeing the progression on where this story is going. And when you see the ending of this issue, and they copied this ending from the Darth Vader issue that I just got done reviewing, about Vader learning something that the Emperor has yet to tell him. This was a great read. I think I liked the Darth Vader issue a little bit more than this, but this was still a solid read. I fucking love this stuff. Marvel is just nailing it out of the park with these Star Wars books. Am I gonna get the Lando book? No. Am I gonna try and get the Kenan the Last Padawan thing? No. I'm just gonna stick with these. And once Leia's done, I'm just gonna stick with Star Wars and Darth Vader because they tie in together so well. This was great. I give it a 4. Unbeatable Squirrel Girl, number 6. Okay, even I know when I have to admit something. The series is fun. I still feel in my heart that this series is the answer, is the direct rival to DC's Harley Quinn series. I really do feel that way. But there's a time when I feel like you can get a little bit too silly with a book. When the silliness tends to get a little overdone and the humor sometimes comes off being a little bit forced. And that's what I felt with this issue. The silliness went a little too far for me, and to be perfectly honest, I didn't laugh a single time reading this book. I spent most of my time when I was reading this book going, seriously? And to me, that hurts the book. That hurts the book tremendously. When it's a book that's meant to be fun, when it's a book that's not meant to be taken seriously, and you're really trying to enjoy it for what it is, it's meant to be silly, it's meant to entertain you, and when it doesn't do that, it hurts it very badly. It's the equivalent of going to a stand-up show and seeing a stand-up comedian go up there and just fucking bomb on every joke. He tells some of the raunchiest or some of the funniest or some of the most delightful jokes he can think of, he or she can think of, and it gets no reaction at all. That's not good, folks. This is kind of how I felt with this issue. Maybe y'all felt a little differently than I did with this, and that's fine. But for me, I just wasn't feeling it. I give this a 2. Oh boy, Wolverine's number 20. Marvel, look at me. Thanks for nothing. Thanks for fucking nothing. Thank you for wasting my time. And thank you for letting me waste my money on this goddamn shit. Where the fuck do I begin? this series had promise. You had the Death of Wolverine storyline, and then you had the Logan Legacy storyline, which built up to this. The Wolverine story. I thought going in at issue one, I thought this series was going to be the big build-up to who's going to be the next Wolverine. If they're not going to bring Logan back right away, who's going to be the next Wolverine? Is it going to be Sabretooth? Is it going to be X-23? It is X-23. Or is it going to be Daken? Or who the fuck ever? And then about halfway down the line, right around halfway down the line, we decided, I guess Marvel decided, fuck it, let's make it about Mystique and her quest to bring back her dead girlfriend, Destiny. Okay, fine. Okay, you can do that and still keep a focus on, and still eventually build up who's going to be the next Wolverine, right? No. By the end of this issue, not only are we not going to be told who the next Wolverine is, not at least not in this series, but Mystique does not get to resurrect her girlfriend. She does not get Destiny back. Wow. And issue 20 ends with, too bad, so sad, by Secret Wars. Screw you, Marvel. Thank you. This was $4 an issue. 20 issues. I spent $80 for fucking nothing. Thanks a lot, Marvel. Thank you a fucking lot. 1.5. Hell, give it a fucking 1. What a piece of crap. We're ending this review with Years of Future Past number 1. Bennett, Norton, this is good stuff. This is, we're getting a glimpse into the Days of Future Past world here on Secret Wars. Imagine if Days of Future Past was ruled by Dr. Doom. You know, that's pretty much what this is. But we get to see all these characters that we knew in this storyline again, and it was good to go back into memory lane with this particular set of characters. You know, seeing, you know, Sideburn, you know, Logan and everything, seeing a middle-aged Kitty Pryde, Colossus and everything. It just felt like taking a trip back in time and seeing where this could go and everything, and it was all fine and good. And we get to see Kitty's daughter Chrissy develop a mutant power. We get to see Wolverine's son's mutant powers and everything. This is really good. I liked the ending of the issue. They dealt with the Sentinels of old. Now it's time to deal with the new Sentinels. And it ends with one of those classic dun-dun-dun kinds of cliffhangers. And it works for me. This was a good read. Was it incredible? No. But for me, it was a fun read. I liked it. I like where they're going with it. Who knows? Maybe I'll stick with it and see where they go from here. My only complaint, my only true complaint, is that this is a $5 book. Is this worth $5? I don't think so. I got this just out of sheer morbid curiosity, and I was pleased enough to stick with it. You know, had it been $2.99 or $3.99, yeah, it probably would have ended up being $3.99. That's probably the normal price nowadays for comics. But a $3.99 price, I would have picked this up without question because, you know, it's these characters and everything. But the $5 price tag made me question or not whether I wanted to get it or not. And that's not good, Marvel. You overprice something and make your customers decide whether or not they actually want to pay you for these stories. That's not good. That's not good business-wise. But, like I said, it was good for what it was. I did enjoy it. I give it a 3.5. Well, that's all I got for this review, everybody. Stay tuned for more. More will be coming just when I get the time to. Thanks again for watching. Don't forget to subscribe. Don't forget to subscribe to Blue Goblin X, Arkham Asylum Studio. Look for me on Twitter, at BlueGoblin01, Tumblr, Pinterest, Facebook. Look for my bro, the Mount Vernon Kid. Look at my buddies, Deadpoolzilla, Brandon Hex. Hex is doing some videos here for, you know, Multiversity, Secret Wars, and all that stuff. Look for Deadpoolzilla as well. Thanks again for watching, everybody. I am Groot. See you later.